from Microsoft, this is the Security Bulletin webcast for August 2013. Now, here's Dustin Childs.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the August 2013 Security Update webcast. I'm Dustin Childs, Group Manager for Response Communications. With me this morning is Jonathan Ness, Security Development Manager for Trustworthy Computing.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us.
So we have a total of 8 bulletins today, 2 re-releases, and a few advisories to cover, and we'll go through those in detail. But we're also here to take your questions regarding the bulletins. As always, we have a room full of people downstairs who are waiting to answer your questions. So if you already have questions, you can start submitting them now by using the Ask button. I see we've gotten 3 questions in already, so hopefully our experts are already working on that. We're also taking questions through Twitter. If you have 140 characters or less of questions, if you do that, please tweet us using the hashtag #MSFTSecWebcast. I've got Twitter snapped up on my screen right now, a little sidebar, so I'm actively monitoring that and would love to hear from you on Twitter as well. So let's start by going through our Severity and Exploitability Index slide. As I mentioned, we have a total of 8 bulletins this month that encompass a total of 23 CVEs. We have 3 critical rated bulletins this month and 5 important related bulletins. 3 of these bulletins receive an XI of 1, and again, this is an aggregate exploit index rating, 2 with an XI of 2, and as always, the denial of service and information disclosure issues default to an exploit index of 3. So Jonathan, I'm looking at this, and immediately I see the Unicode scripts processor that it has an XI of 2 instead of 1. What is it that makes that one a little bit more difficult to exploit?
Yeah, there are a couple of factors that went into that. It is more difficult to exploit. This is a stack-based buffer overflow, and we have a mitigation in place called GS. The GS cookie is put there by the compiler, so a mitigation placed by the compiler, and also the kind of the set of people who are vulnerable by default, you have to have a certain language pack installed, which makes it a little less likely to be exploited than the Internet Explorer bulletin that we'll probably go into in a minute here.
Okay, yeah, and we'll get to those sort of both in detail. Moving on to our deployment slide, we are listing that at MS-1359 and MS-13-060 as our top bulletin deployment priorities for this month. Follow that, we have 4 bulletins listed as our priority 2, with the denial of service issues coming in as a priority of 3. Now, Jonathan, I'm interested as to why we chose the Uniscripts processor over the Exchange server when it comes to getting that top priority. Internet Explorer seems kind of a very obvious DP1 right for me. But then we look at the next two. Both are critical. Both have an XI of 2. What is it that puts Unicode over Exchange?
You know, I think it's really that the set of potentially affected customers. So this is a browser-based issue where the Exchange bulletin really affects the server side only. So that factors into how we stack them up there.
Okay, great. So let's go ahead and look at each of these bulletins in detail, starting with our update for Internet Explorer. MS-13-059 is a cumulative update for Internet Explorer. 9 of the 11 privately reported CVEs could allow for remote code execution. We do have a couple of moderates in there as well for elevation of privilege and for information disclosure. This does get our highest deployment priority rating and has an aggregate exploit index of 1, but as you look through, you'll see some of the CVEs don't affect the latest version of the browser or may have an XI that's slightly lower. So, Jonathan, here we are with another IE update, and for definitely at least the 9 critical CVEs here. It looks like a pretty standard Internet Explorer bulletin. Is there anything really out of the ordinary about this IE bulletin that's a little bit different or maybe something we should pay attention to this month?
Not necessarily. Those are mostly just use after free issues that we've seen typically in Internet Explorer. I guess the one thing is we're also doing a defense in depth change in this update. We're addressing a ASLR mitigation bypass that was found and reported to us at the CanSec West Pwn2Own competition. So we're taking care of that in this update as a defense in depth change.
Okay, so that defense in depth ASLR bypass, is that the sort of thing that someone would chain together with a different vulnerability to actually get it to work on a system? Is that what we're looking at here?
Yeah, that's right. Usually it takes 3 or more vulnerabilities these days to exploit, you know, modern browsers and modern document viewers. I think this issue was used in an Acrobat Reader exploit. So they had to have the memory corruptions issue. They had to have the ASLR bypass, which we're addressing here. Then often you have to have a sandbox escape for the latest Adobe stuff and for browsers.
Okay. Yep. Great. And pwn to own is a topic we'll come back to again when we hit the kernel update.
That's right.
So hold on to that thought. We'll come back to that as well. Let's go ahead and move on, though, to our next bulletin, which is MS-13-060. This is a vulnerability in the Unicode scripts processor component of Windows, which could allow remote code execution. This is our other deployment priority of one bulletin for this month and has an exploit index of 2 for older systems. We have one privately reported CVE here. And Jonathan, as I understand it, and I think you kind of alluded to it before, there's an Internet Explorer component to this issue, but it's not an Internet Explorer vulnerability.
That's right.
What's the interplay like there?
Yeah, this was an issue that shipped with Windows XP and Windows Server 2003. So I guess I would point out first that it doesn't affect the later platforms, but it's a font parsing issue that the browser uses to display these Uniscribe type fonts. It's a kind of a subtype of the OpenType font. So the browser uses this library that comes with the OS.
Okay, great. And since this issue does only affect XP and Server 2003,
right.
This is an opportune time to remind folks that XP and Server 2003 go out of support in April of 2014. So you might want to start thinking about your upgrade strategy now. Moving on to our next bulletin, this is MS-13-061, which is vulnerabilities in Microsoft Exchange, which could allow remote code execution. This is deployment priority of 2 and has an exploit index of 2. We have 3 CVEs here, which were all publicly reported. So, Jonathan, as I saw this, saw this pop up on our board that we're shipping Exchange. And I knew people are going to get nervous, but then I looked through it, and it's like, oh, okay, this is the Oracle outside-in libraries again that we're just repackaging. Is there anything here beyond just those Oracle outside-in libraries that we're servicing?
Nope. Just, you know, once a quarter, Oracle ships an update for a number of their products, and and a few weeks ago, they shipped one for Oracle Outside In, which is a library that provides the, we call it the web view technology, or in Outlook Web Access or Outlook Web App, there's a little link for attachments. You can say, view this in HTML. And if you click that, it'll convert, you know, Word document or PDF or whatever to a HTML page. That technology is Oracle Outside In. We license the technology from Oracle on behalf of our customers. And that's the only thing being addressed with this update. It's not sending mail or any other stuff that Exchange does.
Okay. So, and again, we're mainly talking about Outlook Web Access, web apps and how that's how it displays certain emails.
Right.
What's the impact of these? I mean, we haven't seen any actual customer impact from these issues, even though they have been public.
Right.
But if we were to see any sort of public impact, what would that look like? How would an attacker exploit these issues?
Sure. Now, this is code. This Oracle Outside In library is code running on the Exchange server. So it's not on the browser. It's not on the client at all. It's on the server. The way it could get hit, an attacker sends an email to someone using this victim server, in this case, and the attacker either clicks the link or the victim person on the Outlook web app clicks the link, and then there's code running on the server side, on the Exchange server, to convert that attachment. Now, that code is running at a lesser privilege level, and it's running in a sandbox process. So the extent of the code execution directly from this vulnerability is at a lesser privilege level, but it is code running on the server, potentially code running of the attacker's choice.
Okay. And I do want to clarify one thing, because someone just pointed out that I mistakenly said Server 2003 was also ending in April of 2014.
It's not.
It's Windows XP only that's ending in 2014. Sorry to make people a little nervous there, but I wanted to correct that before we moved on. But yes, for those folks still using XP, again, you've got just a few months before that goes out of support. So moving on, then. So great. Getting back to our Exchange bulletin, let's go ahead and move on now to our MS-13-062, which is the next bulletin in our set. This is for a vulnerability in the remote procedure call, which could allow elevation of privilege. This is a deployment priority of 2 and has an XI of 1 for the one privately reported CVE here. And now, Jonathan, this is an elevation privilege. It affects workstations and servers. And when I look at an EOP, the first thing I want to look at is where am I elevating from and where am I elevating to? So what's the state here that we're going from and to?
Yeah, you know, people sometimes they'll see this RPC and think RPC DCOM, Blaster. In fact, it was the 10-year anniversary recently of Blaster, so unfortunate timing. But this is not like that at all. It's not network. It's nothing about that. So the elevation really is from a user logged on locally on the box is attempting to elevate to the user context of another user also logged on the box. And the way it happens is that other user has to be sending outbound RPC request, and just as normally happens with RPC, that RPC request is executed in that user's context. So if there are enough of those happening, this is it's a race condition or a timing issue. If enough of those are happening in a quick enough frequency, the attacker on that same box may be able to get their request executed in that same context, because the distant end gets confused when there's so many RPC requests. So there's a certain kind of edge case where the attacker on the box can get their code executed on the distant end in the context of another user on the same box.
Okay, so that kind of goes into my next question, which is, I know going back into RPC attacks of years ago that may have been given fancy names, you could go from essentially an unauthenticated person making a call to authenticated. But that's not the case here based on your description. We do have to be authenticated for this to work.
You have to be on the box and running your code on the box even. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not even just I can do this over the network. I have to be logged on to a system then elevate.
That's right.
Okay, great. So let's go ahead and move on to our next bulletin then. This is MS-13-063, which is a vulnerability in the Windows kernel, which could allow elevation of privilege. Deployment priority of 2 here for this update, and we have an exploit index aggregate of 1 for 3 of the CVEs, and of course an NA for that 4th CVE, and let's kind of start with that one.
Okay.
So with the exploit index, we have NA, because this is a security feature bypass.
That's right.
So for this CVE, which is 2556, what is the security feature being bypassed?
It's once again ASLR being bypassed, and this is actually a public, it was presented at CanSec West by a Chinese researcher. It goes by the pseudonym Tomb Keeper. I think we might have talked about him in a couple months ago. Mm-hmm. But he presented an ASLR bypass that he called that uses the function LDR hot patch routine. And this this kernel update changes the way we store memory addresses in the kernel, so that bypass opportunity goes away.
Okay. So again, this is related to the goes back to the pwn to own.
Right.
And with these two updates here, I think we've closed out all of the issues that were reported to us.
Yeah, the last two that were left were those two ASLR bypasses. Mm-hmm. All the vulnerabilities have been taken care of before.
Right, and that kind of, it's interesting to me because, you know, we had the pwn to own issues come up, and we immediately, as soon as we could, we took care of the Internet Explorer vulnerabilities. But then there were these other things that we had to patch, and all of these things together were what it really took to get that pwn-to-own exploit to work.
Yeah.
So it's not trivial as we go through and we look at what actual attacks are.
Yeah, you know, right after pwn-to-own, we posted an SRD blog post that listed all the vulnerabilities and how you had to chain them all together for each of the pwn-to-own exploits. There was the IE remote code vulnerability, and then there's the ASLR bypasses, and there's the sandbox escapes. You got to chain all the stuff together to get a working exploit these days.
Okay, great. Now, we do have 3 other CVEs here, and I want to give them their due as well. For these 3 CVEs, these look like straightforward elevation of privilege.
That's right.
Log on to a system, run a specially crafted program, get kernel-level access.
That's right.
Anything unusual with those?
Nope, they're just code. If you can run an XE and exploit this vulnerability, it's code running in the kernel. This is not, I guess it's not a driver as it often is. Mm-hmm. It's actually an NDOS kernel in this case.
Okay, great. Let's move in to our next bulletin then. This is MS-13-064, which is a vulnerability in the Windows NAT driver, which could allow denial of service, and that's network address translation, if I remember my acronyms correctly. Deployment priority of 3 here, and since this is a denial of service, we have a default XI of 3. We have 1 privately reported CVE. And Jonathan, my question with this is, with every denial of service, I always ask, well, am I stopping a service? Am I stopping the box? Am I blue screening? What level of denial of service are we looking at?
Yeah, I believe this one just stops the service. It doesn't bug check the entire box. So this is a service that was introduced in Server 2012 for the first time. We use it internally at Microsoft for this direct access IPsec layer. It's not on by default, but if you do things like direct access, you may use it in those cases.
Okay, great. And again, that only support this only affects versions of Windows Server 2012. So if you're running a previous server system to that, no action for you here. Moving on to our next update, this is our other denial of service issue. This is MS-13-065, which is a vulnerability in the ICMP v6 component, which could allow denial of service. Again, this is a deployment priority of 3, and again, we default to an XI of 3 since we're talking about denial of service. We also have one privately reported CVE here. And Jonathan, same question as before.
Sure.
Where do we, are we service stop? Are we rebooting? Are we restarting? What?
Yeah, unfortunately, this one's going to be a bug check. So
okay.
it's going to restart the box, and it'll automatically restart. But it is limited to the victim and the attacker both have to be in the same broadcast domain, so probably the same subnet in your network. And it'll be difficult to pull off. You'll probably, on the victim, you'll probably have to have a third-party driver installed, and the memory layout has to be just right. It's got to be right on the edge of a page where it stores the packet. It's tricky to exploit, but yep.
Okay, great. And I know with IPv6, I've set this up, at least in labs before, where these types of router advertisements, they're
right.
really only on like the local system. IPv6
yeah.
handles that a lot differently,
right.
what it considers local.
Yeah.
I think IPv6 in the RFC actually puts the air quotes around the word local. but I mean, there's other IPv6 configurations or network
sure.
device configurations. Can we use those as mitigations here?
Absolutely. If you block IPv6 at the firewall, I mean, that's going to block off this kind of issue. And you know, I'm not sure about the home routers and whatnot, if those will allow IPv6 through. I think some may and some may not.
Okay, and again, we're really talking about getting router advertisements through.
That's right.
So it would
That's
really
right.
be, I have to worry about my kids actually DOSing me on my home network
yeah,
behind my IPv6.
On the same broadcast domain.
Yeah. Okay,
mm-hmm.
great. My kids might do that. You never know. Let's go ahead and move on to our next update. This is MS-13-066, which is a vulnerability in the Active Directory Federation Service, or ADFS, which could allow information disclosure. This is deployment priority 2 bulletin for us and has an exploit index which defaults to 3, again, because we're talking about information disclosure and not the possibility of code execution. We have one privately reported CVE here, and Jonathan, kind of similar to what I do with denial of service, when I look at information disclosure, the first thing is like, great, what information
yeah.
am I disclosing? What sort of risk am I potentially giving out to attackers?
Yeah, you know, it's funny you ask it that way, because this is really information disclosure that could lead to denial of service. So ADFS is this technology we use internally to, and a bunch of companies do, to authenticate to distant domains, like we use Primera for our healthcare coverage. So when I want to put a healthcare claim in, I log into my computer and I just browse the Primera site, and ADFS takes care of all that authentication. Now it does this through XML blobs and all these different ways. So, but in that XML endpoint, the name of the service account being used to provide service for ADFS is disclosed. So the reason I say it could lead to denial of service, and the reason it makes it kind of an interesting vulnerability and worth issuing a security update, an attacker could take the name that's exposed to the world in that XML blob and start trying to authenticate against that. And if you have a setup where you'll disable an account based on so many failed logins, that will disable that service account. And then it'll deny service your ADFS. So it's kind
wow.
of an information disclosure that could lead to denial of service if you lock out accounts.
Okay. That's an interesting attack scenario.
Yeah.
So usually when we deal with information disclosure, we're talking
right.
about PII or some
right.
other sort of thing that could be used for a different type of attack. Here we're disclosing information that could be specifically used to further like shut down ADFS.
Yeah.
And in our case,
yeah.
You mentioned the Corpnet case. It
right,
really
yeah.
could take out our direct access or our VPNs or something along those lines.
Yeah, it's leaking the name of that service account. So
okay.
in whatever way the name of that service account being leaked could be dangerous, that's the scope of the risk, I guess.
Okay. So that is the all of the bulletins that we released yesterday, but we also released a few security advisories too. So let's start by talking with them. We'll start with security advisory 286-2973. So as a part of our ongoing improvements to cryptography, we released this advisory that impacts applications and services that use certificates with the MD5 hashing algorithm. This restriction is limited to certificates issued under the Roots and the Microsoft Root Certificate Program only. This will apply only to certificates utilized for server authentication, code signing, and timestamping. And once that update is applied, applications and services will no longer trust certificates using MD5. It's available for testing now and will be on Microsoft Update starting in February 2014. And we did this with a previous link key length certificate where we released it on DLC, and then 6 months later we pushed it out. So, and Jonathan, I believe that your team covered this kind of in-depth on the SRD blog yesterday. Did you want to run through some of the highlights for us?
Yeah. William did a really nice blog yesterday about this. And he kind of pointed out not just this one change, but kind of the where we've gone the last few months, even the last several months, in the crypto space. Like Dustin mentioned, we put an update out that would restrict keys less than 1024 bits. Now we're doing the MD5. It wouldn't take much imagination to see the future, whereas we're going to keep doing this kind of thing. So if you look at other weak crypto algorithms, DES being one, you can imagine, we're not announcing anything today, but you can imagine we'll keep doing this in the future. In a blog post, it even says, you know, we're on the path here to try and strengthen crypto across the board and get rid of weak crypto. So the blog post is pretty good. It gives a lot more details. It gives links to the KBs and links to the downloads.
Okay, great. And there's the cliche that security is a journey, not a destination. Yeah. I hate that cliche. But it really, in this case, I think it really applies, because there's not one thing we can just flip a switch on and make crypto better. Because as computational power grows, what was MD5 used to be a fantastic crypto algorithm.
Yep.
And Blaster used to be a thing. So, again, we have a decade there, and with computational power, it's now cryptographically weak. So we want to try and get people off of that and onto something that's more appropriate. And we'll see that come up again in the advisory revision we'll talk about here in a few minutes.
Great.
So the next advisory we released yesterday was Security Advisory 286-1855. This security advisory adds defense in depth measures to the network level authentication technology within RDP, and that's NLA. So Jonathan, I looked at this, and this same, it's like, okay, that's great. Why did we do this as a security advisory rather than a security bulletin?
I think it really didn't meet the bar for a bulletin. The bulletins are, we have a bug bar and we say this kind of vulnerability merits a critical class rating. And this kind of vulnerability and these kind of pivots versus server versus clients, it meets the bar for important. This one really didn't meet the bar for a bulletin, but it's still something we wanted to get out there to help customers. This is something we put into Windows 8 first. This was a feature to potentially slow down brute force authentication attempts over RDP. And it worked great in Windows 8, so we wanted to make it available down level as well. So we released an advisory to announce the availability of it, and you can go out and get it.
Okay, great. So we're not really addressing a vulnerability.
Right, yeah, that's
right. So it's not like there's a code fix we can
take. Right.
But the advisory is telling us something. It's like, here's something you can do to improve your overall security. And as I understand it, really what we're doing is, and of course RDP sessions have always been authenticated and encrypted, but now we're taking that level of authentication and just moving it earlier into the session setup. Is that correct? Is that a way to look at it?
It is a way to look at it. The net effect really is it'll slow down attacker brute force attempts. So it'll introduce delays between brute force attempts. And that's been an attack that we have seen in the wild, where an attacker will try and connect to your RDP endpoint and just brute force your logins. It'll be a lot slower for them to do if you have this update in place.
Okay, great. Let's move along to the advisory that we re-released yesterday. This is Security Advisory 285-4544. So following the theme of cryptographic updates, we revised this security advisory to provide a framework to help improve management of specific cryptographic algorithms in Microsoft Windows. This goes hand-in-hand with Advisory 286-2973, which is the MD5 advisory, as it adds configurable options which can be used to limit the usage of weak algorithms, as in MD5 hashing algorithm. and also has a lot of words that are hard for me to pronounce right in a row. So I guess that's the revenge of the MSRT, since I don't pronounce any words this month. So Jonathan, I'm guessing the details about this can also be found in the SRD blog?
Yep, same blog. This framework, as Dustin mentioned, it gives you just a lot more control over what you'll allow in your environment and what you don't want computers in your environment to trust, the kinds of hashing algorithms and kind of key lengths. You just have a lot more control now with this framework out there. It's a good thing we're doing.
Okay, and that really seems like the sort of thing that we should probably put out there on Twitter as well, since we're talking about this specific blog. So what I'll do is, in just a couple minutes, I'll go ahead and tweet this out. So if you're following us, which is at MSFTSecResponse, that's our Twitter handle, I'll post a link shortly that directs you to the SRD Cryptographic Improvements blog. Like I said, I think you mentioned William.
Yeah.
And, it was just William who wrote this.
Yeah,
William did a fantastic
job.
He did a really nice job.
I think Jeremy might have helped him a little bit. But he did a really nice job showing not just what we've done with this release yesterday, but also the history. We first did the 1024-bit length, and then we changed the CTL change so you can manage it yourself. And it just shows the history of where we come in this cryptographic space.
Okay, great. Like I said, I'll tweet that out here shortly. And we do have two bulletin re-releases for this month, MS-13-052 and MS-13-057, both released last month, were re-released yesterday to address certain application compatibility issues discovered after the bulletins were initially released. We recommend all customers install the new updates that apply to their systems. Folks that have automatic updating enabled will not need to take any action. So with that, let's go ahead and move on to our detection and deployment slide. This is our big bingo slide, which I'm still struggling with. But with one minor exception, this month's bingo slide actually has yes across the board. The only exception is the Exchange update is not available through the Windows update system, but it is available on Microsoft update. We also have normal caveats here for NBSA support and a reminder that Windows RT systems are not supported by our enterprise detection tools. Now moving on to our other information about the bulletins. All bulletins replace something except for MS-13-064 and MS-13-066. Everything this month is uninstallable, and three of our bulletins, 60, 61, and 66, won't definitively require a restart, but the other five bulletins released yesterday will. So I kind of mentioned MSRT and getting a break from that this month. As we look at the MSRT, our MSRT partners have not added any families this month, although, again, similar to last month, they haven't taken the month off. They've been hard at work on the version 5 of MSRT, and they're still rolling that out slowly. If you don't want to wait for that, you can always go get it by checking the download center and by manually running the Microsoft update. It will be pushed out automatically to everyone with automatic updates enabled at a later date. Thanks for joining us. Please review the questions and answers transcript for additional information, and you can follow us on Twitter for any late breaking news. Until next month, this is Dustin Childs for Microsoft Security Response.
Please take a moment to rate this video.